everyone, welcome to Looming Maestro. I am your host Vedant Chawla, and today we are going to learn the chapter Air. So what are we waiting for? Let's start with the session. So let's learn what is atmosphere. So the earth is surrounded by a huge blanket of air called the atmosphere. All living beings on this earth are dependent upon the atmosphere for their survival. This is a layer that helps us to breathe and protects us from the harmful effects or the UV rays of the sun rays. Without this blanket of protection, we would be baked alive in the daytime and we would get frozen during the night. This is the mass of air that has made the temperature on the earth livable. Composition of the atmosphere. The air we take in while breathing is actually a mixture of many gases. Nitrogen and oxygen are the two gases which make up the most bulk of the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide, helium, ozone, argon and hydrogen are found in lesser quantities. Apart from these gases, there are also present tiny dust particles. So let's see the composition of the atmosphere. So first comes the nitrogen, which is the most plentiful in the atmosphere, which is 78%. Then comes the second most plentiful gas, the oxygen, which is 21%, that is used for breathing. And then comes the argon, which is 0.93%. Then comes the carbon dioxide, which is 0.03%, and all other gases including the dust particles 0.04%. Importance of gases present in the atmosphere. So let's learn the importance of all the gases, starting with the nitrogen. Nitrogen is the most plentiful gas in the air, as we have seen in the diagram. When we inhale, we take some amount of nitrogen into our lungs and exhale it. But plants need nitrogen for their survival. They cannot take nitrogen directly from the air. So there is a bacterium present in the that live in the soil of roots of some plants that take nitrogen from the air and then convert into a form that the plants can absorb. So this is a simple bacteria that converts the atmospheric nitrogen into a usable form so that the plants can absorb it. And in return, the plants give it shelter and food prepared by the photosynthesis. Importance of gases in the atmosphere. So then comes the oxygen. So oxygen is the second most plentiful gas in the atmosphere. Humans and animals take oxygen from the air as they breathe. Green plants produce oxygen during photosynthesis. In this way, oxygen content remains constant. But if we cut trees, then this balance gets disturbed. Then comes the carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide is another important gas. Green plants use carbon dioxide to make their food and release oxygen. Humans or animals release carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide released by humans or animals seems to be equal to the amount used by the plants, which make a perfect balance. However, the balance is upset by the burning fuels such as coal and oil. As a result, the increased volume of carbon dioxide is affecting the earth's weather and climate. So not only these burning fuels like coal and oil, there is a huge dumps of garbage which are burnt up, and the fumes of the cars which comes in the burning fuels only. So these make a lot of carbon dioxide, and it makes the excessive carbon dioxide. So this excessive carbon dioxide affects us only by the earth, by weather and climate, and hence the balance of the nature is disturbed. So let's see the layers of the atmosphere. So the atmosphere layers are divided into 5 layers. So starting with the troposphere. So troposphere is the layer where most of the weather phenomena occurs, like fog, rainfall, hailstorms, etc. Then comes the stratosphere. So the stratosphere layer is almost free from clouds, and this is 50 kilometers in height. So this is the layer which is the most ideal for flying aeroplanes. And just a point that troposphere is 13 kilometers in height. Then comes the mesosphere. So mesosphere is the layer where most of the meteoroids come and burn up from the space. So this layer is approximately around 80 kilometers in height. Then comes the thermosphere. So the thermosphere layer is used for radio transmissions and communications, where there are satellites present which helps in the communications, and these communications reflect again back on the earth. Then comes the exosphere, where we can fly spaceships entering the and the thermosphere is height is 80 to 400 kilometers, and exosphere enters into the space and is ideal for flying spaceships. Structure of the atmosphere. Our atmosphere is divided into five layers, starting from the earth surface. These are troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, thermosphere and exosphere. So let's learn the troposphere layer in brief. This layer is most important layer of the atmosphere. Its average height is around 13 kilometers. The air we breathe exists here. Almost all the weather phenomena like rainfall, fog and hailstorm occur in this layer. Then comes the stratosphere. Above the troposphere lies the stratosphere. It extends up to the height of around 50 kilometers. This layer is almost free from clouds and is ideal for flying aeroplanes. This layer also contains ozone gas, which protects us from the harmful or the UV rays effects of the sun. Then comes the mesosphere. This is the third layer of the atmosphere. It lies above the stratosphere, extending up to the height of 80 kilometers. Meteoroids burn up this layer on entering from the space. Then comes the thermosphere. In thermosphere, temperature rises very rapidly with increasing height. Ionosphere is a part of this layer. It extends between 80 to 400 kilometers. This layer helps in radio transmission. Radio waves transmitted from the earth are reflected back to the earth by this layer. So comes the exosphere. So this is the uppermost layer of the atmosphere, known as the exosphere. This layer has very thin air, light gases like helium and hydrogen that float into the space from here. So let's learn what is weather and what is climate. So let's start with the weather. Weather is the R2R, day-to-day condition of the atmosphere. Weather can change dramatically from day to day. Weather can be sunny, windy, cloudy or rainy. So what happens is weather is the change, like maybe presently it is cloudy outside my house, and after 2 to 3 years it may be sunny. So this is the R2R, or maybe it might keep raining today and tomorrow it might be sunny. So this is the day-to-day or R2R change in the weather we can see clearly. And where is the climate? The average weather condition of a place for a longer period of time represents the climate of a place. So basically the climate means that it describes how the weather is of a particular place. For example, in India, so India is considered as a hot country because in most of the states or it is a humid country, hot country. So this is how we differentiate between weather and climate. So climate is a longer period of time, like for years the weather is almost same at a particular place, where the weather is the where you can see that this is the hour to hour change, or this is the day to day change. Like it is sunny, it is cloudy, it is stormy, it is snowy, it is rainy, or it is windy. Then comes the temperature. So the temperature we feel every day is the temperature of the atmosphere. So in basically the definition is the degree of hotness or of coldness of the air is known as temperature. So the temperature of the atmosphere changes not only between day and night, but also from season to season. Like summers are hotter than winters. An important factor that influences the distribution of the temperature is insolation. So insolation is the incoming solar energy that is intercepted by the earth. The amount of insolation decreases from the equator towards the poles. So insolation basically is the incoming solar energy absorbed by the earth. Then comes the weather instruments. So there are basically four instruments which helps us to measure different things. Like for if I have to measure temperature of a particular place, I will use thermometer. So thermometer is used for example, you must have seen that there are weather forecasts. So the weather forecasts are calculated by the thermometer only. Then comes barometer. So if I have to measure the atmospheric pressure, I will use barometer. Then comes the rain gauge. So if I have to measure the amount of rainfall of a particular area or a place, I can use rain gauge. And if I have to see the direction of the wind, in which direction is the wind, south, north, east or west, I use wind vane. Then comes the air pressure. So here comes the interesting fact. You will be surprised to know that the air above us presses us with great force on our bodies. However, we don't feel it. This is because the air presses us from all the directions and our body exerts a counter pressure. Air pressure is defined as pressure exerted by the weight of the air on the earth's surface. As we go up the layers of atmosphere, the pressure falls rapidly. The air pressure is highest the sea level and decreases with the height. So you must have seen that if you are living at a plateau or a plain, when you go up hills like Himalayas or like mountains, not only Himalayas, other mountains, so you must feel a bit of difficulty to breathe. That is because the air pressure the air pressure decreases at higher places. So this is known as acclimation. That is the measured how much height do you live above the sea level. So at the sea level you can breathe easily, but if you go up the layers, you will feel difficulty to breathe. That is just because of the air pressure decreases. Then comes wind and types of winds. The movement of air from high pressure area to low pressure areas is called wind. Winds can be divided into three types: permanent winds, seasonal winds, local winds. The trade winds, westerlies and easterlies, are permanent winds. So these are the examples of permanent winds: trade winds, westerlies and easterlies. These blow constantly throughout the year in a particular direction. For example, if the wind is blowing from west to east, it will constantly blow from west to east throughout the year. Then comes the seasonal winds. These winds change their direction in different seasons. For example, monsoons of India. Okay, then comes the local winds. These blow only during a particular period of day or year in small area, for example land breeze and sea breeze. So these local winds are not necessary that if it is blowing in for example X area, it will be blowing in the Y area, though it is the same state or the same city. So these are known as the local winds. Then comes the humidity. So when water evaporates from the land and different water bodies, it becomes water vapor. Moisture in the air at any time is known as humidity. When the air is full of water vapor, we call it a humid day. So before reading further, I would just explain that it is written that on a humid day, clothes take a longer time to dry, and sweat from our body does not evaporate easily, makes us feel uncomfortable. So this is only because that on a humid day, the water vapor is so much in the atmosphere that the atmosphere is not able to take more water vapor from the clothes, and the sweat on our body does not dry easily. So that is known as humidity. And when there is a lot of humidity or the moisture in the air, water vapor, so it forms clouds, and the clouds are water droplets that float into the air. So when these clouds are not able to hold warm water vapor when it is a humid day, there are most chances that it will rain that day, because the clouds will not be able to hold more vapor in it. It will become heavier and heavier, and finally at one day it will rain. Then comes types of rain. When the water vapor rises, it starts cooling. So it starts cooling means the water vapor condenses, causing formation of droplets of water. When these droplets of water become too heavy to float in the air, then they come down as precipitation, as I told you. So precipitation that comes down to the earth in liquid form is called rain. There are three types of rainfall. First, the convectional rainfall, the orographic rainfall, and the cyclonic rainfall. The rainfall is very important for the survival of plants and animals. It brings fresh water to the earth's surface that frees us from the drought. If there would be no rain, all the terrains would be dried, and it would conduct a drought. So thanks for watching my video. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share. Thank you.